Hello, Penguinauts, I'm the Baby Penguin, and welcome back to Kerbal Space Program Beyond Kerbal. This is it. We're finally launching the interstellar mission. Before we can do that, we need to hire ourselves a few more Kerbonauts to bring our crew roster up to 60 Kerbals. We're going to have 6 quartermasters, 10 pilots, 14 scientists slash farmers, 16 engineers, and 14 assorted colonists, all with very important roles. Of course, the quartermaster is going to be managing our logistics, the pilots piloting all our craft and rovers, 14 scientists and farmers all going to be producing our food, the engineers producing our rockets and colony modules, and the colonists are basically just along for the ride to bulk up the numbers, but also going to boost our colony rewards. And they're essentially the families of all the more qualified personnel we're actually sending on this mission. So we're blasting them all up into space on the IEV James Corey, one of our crew condors, of course named after James S.A. Corey, the pen name of the two authors that write The Expanse. Probably my favorite science fiction property, although very closely followed by Red Rising, which is just incredible, and also apparently is getting a TV show soon, which I am mega hyped about. Anyway, each of these condors can carry 31 Kerbals, so it's going to take 2 launches to get all of them up into space. So I think we're launching all the pilots, engineers, and scientists up first, get the Clark all operational, and then we'll send up all the various colonists and get them all settled in, ready for the long journey. As usual, a pretty standard ascent profile, so we're just using the atmosphere and passing it through those fusion reactors for at least the first half of the ascent, and then we switch over onto our onboard liquid carbon dioxide as a propellant. And now, after doing a couple of small maneuvers, we're on our approach to the Clark. I think this is going to be the first time that most of these Kerbals have seen the Clark in all of its majesty, and are. There it is. Isn't it amazing? 28 in-game years and 2.5 real-life years in the making. 2,000 tons, 858 parts, accelerating up to a max speed of 1% the speed of light. Yeah, it's not going quite as fast as it did in our building stream, but that's because in the stream it didn't have the 750 tons of colony cargo on board. And also, we were just spending all of the fuel just to see how fast we could get it going. Obviously now we're actually going to have to decelerate at the other end, so we can't use more than half of our fuel in the acceleration phase of the mission. It's going to take it about 74 days to get up to speed, so thank God that Kerbal Space Program Interstellar Extended actually adds a persistent thrust through time warp function. Otherwise, this may have destroyed my will to live. But thankfully, we could whack it up to maximum time warp while the engine was firing, which made this mission significantly more bearable. Look at that mighty Daedalus engine on the back. 3,000 kilonewtons of thrust at 1.5 million seconds of ISP. It is truly a marvel of Kerbal engineering and ingenuity, but not actually the most powerful and efficient propulsion system we can use. A little bit more on that later, but there is actually one more big step we can take, which we'll be using on our second generation missions out into the cosmos. But here we are, we have the Corey just docking. It takes a little bit of finagling to get to rendezvous. You see there, showing just the sheer scale of this spacecraft. And we get it all operational and activate all the very pretty lights around those centrifuge rings. So once we've dropped off 30 of our colonists, we just keep Katrina Kerman, our ace pilot, in the pilot seat, and we send it back down to the surface to pick up the next load of colonists. You see there, for some reason, it shows that there are a bunch more Kerbals on board than there actually are. Katrina's the only one on board. It just quick saving and reloading fix that. We've had that bug a couple of times in this save file. It's a little bit strange, showing Kerbals in the craft that aren't actually on board. Anyway, getting a rather beautiful shot of the Clark there, just receding into the distance, and we're going to head back down to the surface of Solitude. This is actually the last time that Katrina is likely going to set foot back on the surface. This is a one-way trip. They're going to go out there, set up this colony, and prepare for future colonists to arrive, but they're not going to be coming back home. The whole point of this mission is we are evacuating Kerbalkind from Solitude, and I believe there are only a couple hundred thousand of them left. Now, although Solitude has a breathable atmosphere, since it's tidally locked to Archangel, There's only a very narrow habitable section just along the Terminator line where the Kerbals can actually live, so there's really not all that much living space. And it was only about a couple of thousand that managed to escape from Kerbin in the first place, so that shows why it's taken quite so long for them to rebuild the space program and actually get to evacuating themselves to another star system. So it's taken about 1,000 years or so for them to get this far, but you know, probably surviving was their first priority when they landed here on Juna, and then they gradually managed to rebuild their society and head back out into the cosmos. It's not a very graceful landing there, but we managed to thankfully get it down in one piece. I was trying to show off again and land without using the parachutes, but landed a little bit hard and ended up tumbling over. But here we are, the final batch of colonists. I've had a few people tell me that I have to evacuate every single Kerbal on Solitude. I mean, just think about the amount of time it's taken to build the Clark just to carry 60 Kerbals out there. I mean, I guess once we have the colonial set up, it would literally just be a giant meat ship just filled with cryopods. We wouldn't have all the colony modules and everything, but even so, launching 30 Kerbals at a time into orbit, how long would it take us to launch hundreds of thousands of them, let alone somebody telling me I had to transport 4 billion Kerbals to another star system? It's not going to happen. We're just going to infer that other colony ships are going to follow afterwards. Yeah, because this mission alone took more than long enough. You see there, just getting a rather awesome view, actually, of the approach to the Clark from inside one of the crew compartments. And you see all the Kerbals very, very excited to be heading out to a new home. They are pioneers, where no Kerbals have ever been before. So all the planets we've been exploring in this after Kerbin planet overhaul have actually been visited before by Kerbal kind, but now they've just been remarkably changed by all the various different changes taking place across the solar system due to Kerbal's expansion. But now we have all the Kerbals on board, our transfer window has been reached, and we are ready to blast off to Valentine. There is literally no better way of doing this, no more precise method than literally just pointing at the star and burning. No maneuver node is capable of planning this. Even using an automatic maneuver node planner, mech jeb, none of them can do it. You literally just have to point at the star, burn, and then make course corrections when you get there. And it turns out we're not even going to have patched conics, so we're not going to know when we're going to enter the sphere of influence of Valentine until we literally enter the sphere of influence, and we don't know what our trajectory past the star is going to be, so we have to wait quite a long time before we can even make any course corrections. So yeah, my hands were a little bit tied, but there we go, we've activated the Daedalus engine, and now I'm going to pass over to my past self to walk you through the various different systems of the Clark from stem to stern. As soon as we get out of the sphere of influence of Solitude, we're going to extend this thing, and it is a massive great big magnetic shield, because of course when you're traveling at 1% the speed of light, even a tiny mote of interstellar dust could rip through this entire ship and destroy it. So as well as protecting us from solar wind, it's also going to be protecting us from gas in the interstellar void. It has also got a secondary purpose though. As well as shielding us from dust particles, it's going to be collecting hydrogen, which we're then going to be feeding into the particle accelerators in our centrifuges. That's right, each of these centrifuge rings, they actually have a secondary purpose as particle accelerators. Because you've got a giant ring, you know, built-in particle accelerators, I'm sure it doesn't bother all the Kerbals living in very close proximity to them. And what we're going to be doing, as soon as we're out of the sphere of influence and we finish the burn, is feeding interstellar hydrogen into them and smashing them together to get antimatter. Because if you thought that helium-3 was a difficult fuel source to obtain, antimatter is a whole different ballgame. I want to use it as a second generation ship's fuel source. It's going to be even more powerful because, especially with KSP-2 getting delayed, I think we're going to explore multiple stars in this series. Valentine is more of an orbiting star around Kerbal. It's not all that far away. Obviously, it's about 0.1 of a light year away. Or 0.01 actually, I think. In Kerbal light years, it's 10% of a light year. away. But I want to go to even more distant stars, even more distant worlds. But we're going to need some more powerful propulsion for that. Well, more importantly, some more efficient propulsion. So antimatter propulsion is going to be the way to go. And I think I'm going to design a craft based off the ISV Venture Star from Avatar. So this ship is going to be gradually producing antimatter over the course of its mission, though it's probably going to take decades to produce enough to actually fuel up another ship. But to aid in that, we also have a bunch of antimatter collectors, which can very gradually pick up particles of antimatter, especially from strong magnetic fields. So we might leave a Clark in the orbit of a gas giant sitting in one of its radiation belts to harvest antimatter as well. So we've got two different ways of getting antimatter. As we work our way along, you see we've got these orbital shipyards, because of course the Clark's going to need to produce things in orbit. As soon as it gets to our new home, it's going to be doubling up as an orbital construction dock. It's essentially going to become the Tycho of the new system, at least for a while, because it's going to be mostly out of fuel. So until we figure out a way to refuel it, it's not going to be taking us anywhere else. So we're going to have to use it as a massive space station, a portable space station, during the early stages of colonization. Then, of course, we have our habitation section of the Clark. So we have these massive centrifuge rings that are producing a lot of hab time for our Kerbals, keeping them fit and healthy over the duration of the long journey. And then in this hab section here, we have a number of agroponics modules. Now, each of these can support 6 Kerbals, I believe. So we have more than enough of these to be taking the mulch that the Kerbals produce and a little bit of fertilizer, of which we have quite a bit on board, and then turning it back into supplies that the Kerbals can eat. Working our way along, we have a bunch of recycling modules, just reduces the strain on our life support systems. And then we have cryonic freezing chambers. We have just enough to freeze all 60 of the Kerbals that are on board. Although, I don't think I'll actually be using this. If I can get away without freezing the Kerbals, then I would like to do that. We only have enough glycerol on board to freeze them and unfreeze them all once. So I might save that, because as far as I'm aware, we don't actually have a way of producing glycerol in situ. We have to actually ship it here from Solitude. Perhaps I'll actually add a part that can produce it later for some of our later missions. But if I can get away without freezing the Kerbals, then I'd like to do that. And I think we have more than enough supplies. I just wasn't sure whether we'd have the hab time supplies to actually support 60 Kerbals, but I think we're absolutely fine. So that brings us to the end of this module. A bunch of these are just Kerbitats, just increasing the habitation time. So most of these Kerbals, yeah, they can stay here for up to 4 years. And the more experienced ones, I'm pretty sure, can stay here indefinitely. And then just up here, we have, I think, a few logistics modules. We have a med bay, we have some workshops, just bits and bobs from USI to help us out. Then moving back, let's have a look at some of these different modules, shall we? Of course, we have the crew condor, the IEV Cori, which brought all the crew members up. But we also have a cargo variant down here, which is just going to carry machinery, specialized parts, fertilizer, supplies, material kits, all that good stuff up and down. To and from the Clark, because we're going to be producing material kits and specialized parts at our colony, but we're going to need to ship them up into orbit so we can build things in orbit. I'm pretty sure this is called the Asimov, named after, of course, Isaac Asimov. Then we have the Colony Command Center, and it has a bunch of modules and some engines on it just to help it get down to the surface. It's covered in parachutes, but a lot of this stuff will be ripped off once we get down to the surface. This has, of course, our assembly plant, where our Kerbals are going to be sitting while they build all the other modules we need. As soon as we get down to the surface, this is going to provide the power we need for the colony, and it's just a central command station, and the Kerbals are going to sit here and use supplies from this supplies module. This is just packed full of specialized parts and material kits, and we're going to use this to build a couple of habitation pods and also to build the industrial module, which isn't here because it's absolutely massive. There's no way I was going to get that down to the surface. So we're going to build that on the surface of the world. And once the industrial module is going, we can actually then produce material kits and specialized parts in situ and produce the rest of the colony. A lot of the colony, especially all the hab modules for all the Kerbals, are going to have to be produced in situ, because it would have been at least another 1,000 tons worth of stuff to build all of them. And then, of course, we are taken to these little mining pods. You see, we've made them significantly more compact than the ones that we used on Nemesis. I've figured out, you know, how to actually compact them down. We only need a few drills And there's one for each different resource we're going to need. So we've got water, minerals, silicates, all the different input resources we're going to need for all our different production chains to start producing things. So one of these is probably going to have to land in each different biome. Until we get there and do an orbital survey scan, we have no idea what resources we're going to find. But we'll do an orbital survey scan, we'll get into polar orbit, and then we'll drop each of these first. Although we'll probably send some Kerbals down to plant a flag, but then we'll start dropping these things into each of the different areas to start mining resources. Once the base has landed, we'll also build a rover so that which can travel between them and collect resources. So they'll just sort of be in various biomes relatively near, probably within about 50 kilometers of our colony site, so we can collect resources from them easily. But then moving our way back, of course, we have these massive graphene radiators. They don't look quite as cool as the titanium ones, but they're significantly better, significantly lighter as well. So with a bunch of these, I'm pretty sure we're almost reaching our thermal equilibrium. We're not going to get anywhere near dangerously high heat levels. But they're going to glow red hot for most of the journey, because they're going to have to dissipate a lot of heat from this thing. You see here we have all of our fuel tanks filled with fusion pellets made of deuterium and helium-3, which we've been producing over the course of the last 3 years or so while we were waiting for Morningstar to come back. And then at the back we have the Clark's main reactor. It's a larger version of the reactor that's going to power the colony. And this is also fueled by deuterium and helium-3. And then, of course, we have this massive radiation shield to protect all of our onboard Kerbals from the neutron radiation produced by this engine. And then at the back, we have the mighty Daedalus inertial confinement fusion engine. So you've probably noticed that we've simplified our logistics by pretty much powering everything on this mission with helium-3 and deuterium, which is all very well, but that means we actually have to find a supply of especially helium-3, one of the rarer elements to find on planetary surfaces, to actually fuel this mission and refuel this spacecraft once we've decelerated, because it's not going to have any fuel left. And we want to be visiting possibly other star systems, but more likely with the Clark just exploring the various different planets around Valentine. So there are a few different places you can get helium-3. You can get it from deposits on airless worlds, deposited there from the solar wind. Slight problem, Valentine is a relatively young red dwarf, so it hasn't really been battering its planets and moons with solar wind for all that long. Also, its solar wind is significantly weaker than that of Archangel, which is a red giant at this stage. And also, we can't even guarantee that there are going to be any airless worlds that we can really feasibly mine helium-3 from. So what's the second option, Beardy? Well, we can pretty easily extract it. I say easily, but it is abundant in the atmospheres of gas giants. Yes, we're going to be harvesting deuterium and helium-3 from the atmosphere of a gas giant. And we're not going to skimp out and just dip into the upper atmosphere and skim small bits at a time. No, we're going to build a cloud city, a floating colony in the upper atmosphere of Hebe, which is a hot Jupiter in low orbit around Valentine. Then we're going to have a probably antimatter powered shuttle, because it's going to need a lot of delta V to do this, but it's going to descend down to the surface, pick up a bunch of fuel from the floating colony by landing on a landing pad on top of it, and then blast back up into orbit where the Clark will be waiting, and then we'll fuel up the Clark like that. I think that's going to be absolutely awesome. I don't know if anyone's even done that in KSP before. I know people have built sort of flying colonies with the rotors. We're going to be using a combination of the Heisenberg airship mod and the airpark mod, which lets you freeze things in place above the surface of a planet to actually freeze the colony there so we can swap to other vessels. I don't think anyone's ever done that, and I think it's going to be really, really cool. I know Luris in my Discord, little shout out for him, he's actually been experimenting with it and making sure that it works before I declare I'm going to do it, and he's got it working, and he needs a massive counterweight to keep it stable, but it does actually work. We'll probably have another building stream, though, where I get that working, because I get the impression that's going to need a lot of testing and a lot of sort of fiddicking about to finally get it working before I actually build that and actually launch it into the atmosphere of a gas giant. But you can see there, we have finally finished the acceleration phase of our mission. It took 74 days to accelerate up to speed, and we're not quite going at 1% the speed of light. I wanted to play things a little safe and save a little bit of fuel so that we can actually travel to Hiba once we've set up the colony and then launch our floating colony into the upper atmosphere. Of course, we're going to have to build the floating colony from the Clark, so we'll have to launch material kits up to it and then build the colony in orbit and then send it down into the atmosphere. But yeah, we're going to need some fuel to actually travel to different planets around Valentine. So I've spent probably about, we've spent almost half, but I'm just leaving a little bit extra. So we're at about 0.8% the speed of light right now instead of 1%. It's a little bit of a shame. We didn't quite reach that magical 1% number, but it doesn't really matter. This trip isn't going to be all that long either way. However, I did encounter a little bit of an issue. It turns out I completely miscalculated the number of recyclers that we need because I forgot that they each only support 3 Kerbals instead of 6. So we currently only have enough recyclers to support 36 Kerbals. And there are 60 on board, so yeah, our life support is draining faster than those agroponics modules can actually produce it, so we're going to have to freeze almost half of our crew. It's all just the non-essential personnel, the colonists and everything. I was hoping to be able to do this without freezing anybody, and I could have if I had calculated the number of recyclers that I needed properly, but there were so many different factors that went into this mission that I just didn't get around to even thinking about it. I just assumed that we had enough recyclers, and I've only found out at this point that we didn't have enough. You see there the UV laser that's built into the magnetic nozzle, firing an ionizing gas in front of the Clark so that the magnetic nozzle can actually suck it in. So now we're just going to turn around and we're going to start the deceleration stage of the mission. We've actually got at this point our particle accelerators in the rings. They're producing pretty sizable amounts of antimatter. I say sizable, they're producing like micrograms at a time, but now we've collected enough interstellar hydrogen, we can pretty much start our antimatter factory going. We've got more than enough hydrogen to keep it going for decades, so yeah, we can close that magnetic scoop. I mean, it's not even facing the direction we're traveling anymore, but we're going to decelerate a bit, and then we can actually close that scoop for the final stage. So yeah, it's going to take quite a while to decelerate. It took us 74 days to accelerate up, and we're actually going to spend about 60 days here just to accelerating down before we start making course corrections. So we just get ourselves down to a big round number and get ourselves within the sphere of influence of Valentine before we start making course corrections. So we want to be heading to Fust. We've decided from the Endurance's scans that it's probably the most the promising colony candidate. So we're going to be heading straight there. I wonder if we have Fust or Bust written on the side of the Clark. That would certainly be a missed opportunity if we didn't. But you see here, these maneuvers, thank God for the maneuver node editor, which you can just whack up to the maximum value, because even just plotting these maneuvers took like 10 minutes because of the amount of delta V that they use. And we were playing with hundreds of kilometers per second ago and burns that take place over multiple days here. I've just never had a mission anything like this, and it really was a lot of fun. Just in completely new territory for me with regards to playing Kerbal Space Program. You can see here, though, we're trying to line up our trajectory so that it's going to be pretty much parallel with Fust's orbit, meaning that we're going to save ourselves quite a bit of delta V, because Fust will have a fair bit of velocity in the same direction that we're traveling, so we won't have to decelerate quite as much. And then all we have to do is do our final braking burn just to make sure we arrive at that point in Fust's orbit at the same time that Fust does, and then we'll do a final braking burn and orbital insertion. I'm surprised this worked out as well as it did. It took a lot of time, a lot of planning of maneuver nodes, with the burns taking multiple days to the point where they even break the maneuver node planner. It just can't even comprehend the size of these burns and the amount of time they're going to take. It did provide a few problems, but it was really its own reward. This is really, really cool. You can see there, we're starting to see as distant points of light, various different planets of Valentine, which we did actually tour when the Endurance did its flyby. The Endurance took 11 years to get here, but we've managed to get here in around about 300 days, so 10 times faster than the Endurance. And the Endurance didn't even have any fuel to slow down. It was literally just a star shot, just a flyby to get a few pictures of the planets and see if we had any candidates for colonization before we, you know, spent all these resources building a massive manned mission. But there we have it. We have our encounter with Fust, and now we can perform our final insertion burn and arrive at a new home for Kerbal Kind. But that will be in the next episode. Thank you very much for watching, everyone. I've been the Beardy Penguin. I do hope you have enjoyed, and I do hope you're as excited for the next episode as I am, where we'll be arriving at a new home for Kerbal Kind, dropping our colony modules, and setting up a first landing site. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you all next time.